So, in continuation of the series of Myth and Mind, today we are delving into yet another character, which is Karna from Mahabharata. So far in the series, we've been looking at different mythological characters with the intention of looking at how do we reinterpret their stories given the context of our times, and also given that the very term myth, if you look at the origin of the term myth, which is mythos in Greek, it means spoken truth. So we are holding myths with an assumption that it is spoken truth about life in general, life and the universe and the way we function. And yet mythology as we know it has been in the recent years interpreted through the lens of mythology, through the lens of sociology, religion, politics and so on. So there has been several variations in terms of how we perceive myths. A lot of us have also grown up with the confusion of mythology partially being considered historical truth. And so yes, there is very often a very blurred line between history and mythology. However, in the context of this series, I'm holding the idea of myth purely as philosophical spoken truth and not necessarily looking at it as any kind of a historical fact. So, in the spirit, so far we've explored several characters and looked at learning through the journey of these characters and looking at what do these characters mean for us in our lives, how do they play out through us. So far we've looked at the characters of Arjuna, of Prometheus, and then the last time we spoke of Psyche. Back from the Greek myth, we are coming back into Indian mythology today and looking at Karna and the story of Karna. Before we get into the story, I would want to spend some time looking at the framework that we spoke about in the very first part of this series, where we said there are several lenses through which mythology can be interpreted. And for me personally, this is one of the lenses that has been extremely valuable. So this is the septenary framework by Helena Blavatsky, and Blavatsky of course presented and in a way downloaded and channeled this framework in a certain context, and I believe it's fairly agnostic in terms of how we utilize it for our own benefit. So the framework primarily says that all of us as life forms have two planes of existence. One is the rupa, the form, where there is a physical existence, that this is life as we experience it, where the physicality is really tangible. And there is the aspirational plane of the arupa, the non-form, something that does not have physicality and yet exists as states of energy and consciousness. So if you look at the, for lack of a better word, levels, although it's not necessarily a hierarchy in the strict sense of the term, when we're talking about the levels of the rupa, we're talking about these four levels, which are sthula, linga, prana and kamavanas. So sthula is, if I have to interpret it from our context, from the human context, sthula is consciousness of our physical body, the physical gross matter, right? The fact that we feel hunger, we feel physical pain, we feel cold or hot, or discomfort in our body, that's the awareness or the consciousness of the sthula, right? And there are several life forms that have consciousness in the sthula. If you look at any mineral form, which could be a plastic for example or a stone, it also exists in the sthula. It's just that for a mineral or a plant, for a mineral specifically, the sthula is the only form of consciousness that it has access to, and everything else is in potential. Right? So the mineral can grow in consciousness if it attempts to. For example, we see coal becoming crystal or crystalline, which is turning from the gross matter into light, reflecting light. So there is a possibility of consciousness that exists only in the sthula to also progress and access more potential. But there are certain life forms that are more embodied in the sthula, and there are others that also have access to other planes of existence. So we of course have awareness of our physical matter, our gross body, and we also have, I've got the order wrong there, there's prana. Prana is one breath, which is the most common interpretation of it, but prana is also life force moving through us and awareness of life force moving through us. In the human context, we say a person is dead when the person stops breathing, right? So breath is at the center of our existence as we know it. So that's prana. And prana is again experienced by several life forms, including plants. Right? Plants experience prana in the form of conversion of carbon dioxide into oxygen, conversion of sunlight into chlorophyll, and therefore they work with life forces, energy forces that are outside of them, transmute them in order to be able to survive. And of course plants, we can see in a very physical manner that they do tend to move towards the light. You plant a seed, it grows towards the sun. So that there is an increasing level of consciousness from just the sthula into prana. And then the third step there is the linga. Linga is consciousness of emotions, which we as humans of course feel, animals feel it too. So emotions which could be as primal as fear and anger and sorrow, and also the more evolved emotions of happiness, of compassion, of connection and so on. And there is the karma manas, which for us as humans is extremely potent, right? Karma manas is the mind, and it is a subjective mind. So if you look, there's a slight distinction and a gap between the karma manas and the manas, which is pure manas, pure objective mind. Our mind is subjective in that when I talk of mind, I'm talking of it from my perspective. So there is my reality and my world and my relationship and my perspective, right? Whereas manas in an enlightened, evolved sense of the term is objective mind, which holds everything. Whereas in the human context, there is always a certain lens, a certain perspective that one needs to work with. So those are components or levels of an embodied form. And our aspiration as a whole, of course, is to move towards a heightened state of existence, which is formless, which does not need a physical embodiment, which is that of the manas, which is pure mind, objective intelligence. There is the buddhi. Buddhi is cosmic intelligence, and there is the atman, which is soul at the highest level. Of course, we can't really have much of a definition for those three, given that we don't really exist in those planes of existence yet. We are still grappling with the rupa. The reason I'm bringing this in today in the context of Karna is because the attempt is to look at how did Karna deal with specifically the rupa, right? When it comes to the idea of dharma, which is central to Mahabharata, the epic that Karna is a part of. If we have to extrapolate that framework and look at what are the parallels that we as a society have drawn of that framework into other spaces in our lives. One specific reference to it is temperaments, right? And temperaments which eventually of course got interpreted as varnas, as caste, and then caste at some point became a way of social stratification, which my belief personally is that that was not what it was intended to be. It was purely a measure of temperament, and looking at based on what the temperament of a person is, where does his or her or their dharma lie? Dharma as in the sense of duty, where do they evolve, what do they evolve into in a particular embodiment? So if we have to draw a parallel, and this is purely a personal way of referring to it, saying that someone whose consciousness is largely in the sthula, which means someone whose state of awareness is largely stuck to the body, the gross matter, the needs of the matter, that person in that sense is in the state of the Shudra in that moment, and it's a momentary state, and it's possible that we go up and down those temperamental states all the time. So when my consciousness is stuck in the sthula and I keep saying, for example, that I'm really hungry and I'm craving for this particular kind of food right now and I want it right now, and if I happen to do that at the cost of everything else that's happening around me, and in the process I become inconsiderate of everything else around me, then my temperament is that of what is labeled as the Shudra, which is that I need to learn to be considerate, and therefore I need to learn to serve not just my own needs but also that of others. Which, and therefore my guess is, at some point in time the temperament got evolved into a professional stratification where one said that a Shudra needs to be in the service profession, not so much because he or she belongs in a certain family, but because the temperament needs to learn service. I need to learn to look beyond my physical needs and the fact that I'm hungry and I'm sleepy and therefore look at something beyond me. And service is a beautiful way to learn that, to learn to look beyond me. So if you look at how the caste system unfortunately interpreted it, it became a sense of stuckness where you said someone who's born into a Shudra labeled family becomes a Shudra, which I guess is a rather unfair judgment, but I'm looking at a different interpretation of it here. Similarly, if one's consciousness is predominantly in the prana, which means it is predominantly in terms of looking at what gives me breath, what gives me life force, what makes me feel nourished, then the temperament becomes that of a Vaishya. The temperament is that of wanting to trade. I trade carbon dioxide so I get in oxygen. And therefore the idea of merchant professions being categorized in the Vaishya label, which is that the temperament is to look at what can I give, what can I take, and what makes for a fair exchange with life. How do I transact with life? Then there is the predominant consciousness of the Linga, which is the predominant consciousness of emotions, of pleasure, what makes me feel good, what makes me feel bad, what makes me happy or sad. And the fact that I recognize my own emotions also allows me to some extent to also be sympathetic, to be empathetic, and to also recognize that if I can feel happy or sad about something, so can someone else. And therefore can I temperamentally now look at being a warrior for the good of all, not just for my own good, but for the good of all, because I recognize that my good also comes in when there is a collective good. And therefore the idea of the Kshatriya, the idea of the warrior, in our world today we are seeing a lot of these warriors arise and fight for what is needed. We've in the last week heard Greta Thunberg speak in the UN as a climate warrior, right? So that sense of saying there is emotion, there is hurt when I see the planet being hurt, and I want to do something about it, not just for myself but for the collective, and therefore when I fight through my Linga, I fight not just for me but for the collective. And there is the temperament that is anchored in the Kama Manas, in the mind, which is potentially the Brahmin temperament, which is to say, can I step beyond myself, my family, my needs, everything that is me, 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 to start looking at where do we need to go as a world? Okay. How are we connected to the larger cosmos, the higher questions in life, the philosophical questions in life, which all of us need to aspire to, and yet collectively that part of temperament is really an aspirational state for the world as a whole. It's not something that one can simply be born into. It is something that one really needs to cultivate, to let go of the ego and then work at a level where one is thinking of only the collective good and not of the self. We perhaps have across the world a few saints or some people who've maybe managed to live up to that temperament in terms of completely giving up the personal good to only look at the collective. We have examples like a Mother Teresa who worked largely for others and not for self. So, but those are few and far between in terms of that temperament. Now, the reason we are bringing this piece in is that one of the lenses through which the story of Karna in Mahabharata can be interpreted is through the lens of temperament. From the in many ways, the story of Mahabharata is also the story of how temperaments at some point evolved into social stratification, castes, and how castes played out against each other in the battle of Kurukshetra. Karna, when he was born into what was deemed a Brahmin family, a family that, in a Kshatriya family, a family that fought for the good of all, a family that produced kings and queens, and they were royal for generations together. Unfortunately, he happened to be born to an unwed mother, a mother who had, well, there are many ways to interpret this, but the story goes that when she was, when Kunti, his mother, was about 5 years old, she served a hermit for a long while very well, and the hermit was really pleased. This was Sage Durvasa. He was really pleased, and he granted her a boon, saying, "You can have children with five entities that you choose to have as a father to your children." And she was still unwed. She was a young teenager, and it is said that she got curious about whether the boon really works or not. And in the process of curiosity, happens to invoke the sun god, invokes Surya, the central light, the central masculine form in our solar system. And so Karna is born, and she realizes that while the boon was true, she still happens to live in a society that judges her for the fact that she has an illegitimate child, and therefore she has to let go of the child. Eventually, the child that is led down the stream is picked up by a charioteer who works with the kingdom of Kurukshetra, of the kingdom of Hastinapur, and the charioteer, who's in the service profession, is the temperamentally a Shudra, happens to raise the child. So here is someone who happens to be born into a Kshatriya family. All along, his identity is that of a Shudra. And because of the fact that he's a Shudra in a society that believes in stratification, he struggles. He realizes his skills are way beyond that of the service profession. He's a fabulous archer. He's great at studying politics and warfare and strategy, which largely are domains of the intellectuals, of the Kshatriyas. And yet he's not given access to any of those because of his Shudra identity. And battle after battle, in a personal sense, ensues for Karna across his life, till at one point in time Duryodhan discovers him, and they befriend each other, and in the process he is made a king of one of the small kingdoms that submit to Hastinapur. So, and yet, even after the fact that he's named a king, he's still regarded as a Shudra king. He's not granted the social acceptance of a Kshatriya king. Now, what happens in this process is there is a personal identity and there is a social identity. he knows all through the story that his personal identity is that he does not necessarily belong temperamentally into the family and the community that he's brought up in. Temperamentally, he's far more evolved. He knows strategy, he knows politics, he knows warfare, all of that. And yet his struggle is to figure out, should I remain loyal to the community that's holding me back? Or should I step out and move in and demand acceptance into a community that I'm temperamentally a part of? And he remains in that struggle pretty much till the end of his life. And it's interesting how it plays out. And I'm going to bring in Carl Jung here, because a lot of Karna's life is about dealing with his shadows, dealing with aspects of his personality which he does not acknowledge or work with. Carl Jung, the father of psychoanalysis in many ways, says, until you make the unconscious conscious, it'll direct your life, and you will call it fate. Right? And this is so true for all of us, in that there is so much in us that is unconscious, that we are not aware of. And till the time I accept it and learn to work with it, it might erupt and I have no control over it. I will call it destiny. So, for example, if I happen to have, let's say, a deep-seated prejudice about men in general, right? And I'm not aware of the prejudice, but it acts out in, let's say, relationships, in conversations, in the way I interact with the world. I might let those eruptions, I might let that prejudice, that anger against men lash out in multiple ways. I may be cruel to people that I work with, I may behave terribly to the men in my family. And then I would wonder, why are all these men going away from my life? And therefore I would call it fate, but it's really my shadow. It's the fact that I can't see the fact that I have a prejudice and I'm working through, and the prejudice works through me, the shadow works through me. A lot of Karna's story was about living in the shadows. The shadow of the Brahmin, the shadow also of the Kshatriya, playing out in a big way. You will hear all through the Mahabharata many, many stories where Karna is asked to donate things to charity, right? And therefore he also earns the epithet Danvir Karna, a person who is extremely generous. And at many points in life, there are people who come and ask things of him, which are material things, which are other things in kind, and he never says no. Not because he cannot say no, he is very much in his rights to refuse when he needs to, but temperamentally he doesn't know how to, because he's never claimed the fact that he's a Kshatriya. And therefore, one of the last instances where this happens is where the day before he's supposed to fight Arjuna in the Mahabharata war, Krishna comes to him in the form of a Brahmin to trick him, to test him. There are multiple ways to interpret it. I would think it's also for him to get another chance to see, do you really want to accept your temperament and get on with it, get done with the Shudra identity and claim the fact that you are a Kshatriya. Karna doesn't, and Krishna asks for the armor that Karna is born with, and that armor is like a way of protection. It's like how Achilles had his heel which was unprotected. Karna without the armor was unprotected. And because a Brahmin asked it, Karna gave it away. And here is where the shadow operates. Here is where generosity without discernment becomes dangerous. When you happen to give something to someone who does not deserve it, just because the person happens to have asked for it and you struggle to say no, you're doing yourself and the other a great disservice, and he does not realize that. And sure enough, because he happens to make that choice, eventually the day before the war he also learns that he is indeed a Kshatriya, he is indeed Kunti's son. And there's nothing he can do about it. that again was a pivotal moment in the Mahabharata war, where Karna has a choice to say, hey, I'm going to step up as the eldest Pandava, I'm within my rights to do that, and if I am in my rights to do that, I can step up and mediate and say that both of these sides do not need to go to war, because ultimately it's this one family. But he refuses to accept his shadow. So the Kshatriya remains in the shadow, and the Shudra identity is what he ends up dying with. Some versions of the Mahabharata say that the dying wish of Karna is that in another incarnation, in the next time that I'm embodied, I want to get over that Shudra identity and completely claim my generosity in a conscious way. And the story goes that he apparently is born in a different space, in a different family, and actually ends up claiming his generosity and moves over the temperament of the Shudra and the Vaishya and the Kshatriya and goes on into a Brahminical space of mind. But yeah, the point of interpreting the story in this particular way is looking at Arjun as the center of Mahabharata and looking at the shadow side of it, the Karna as the center of Mahabharata. Arjun's fight was a conscious fight. He knew who he was. He accepted his personality. He accepted the responsibility, the dharma, the duty that came as a part of his personality. And when I use the term dharma here, I'm talking of what is my duty given my temperament. If my temperament, for example, is to be extremely concerned with my body and my physical needs and my physical pain and my hunger, then my duty towards evolution is to learn to serve so that I get over myself and my physicality. If my temperament and my obsession and my state of consciousness is really about transaction, it's about getting more from life, it's about give and take, then my duty is that of a Vaishya. My duty is that of looking at how do I give and take in an ethical manner. And therefore, a profession that is in the nature of business helps me do that, helps me find the opportunity to do that. In the case of Karna, it was temperamentally his duty to fight for the larger good. And what he unfortunately ended up doing as a matter of social conditioning is fight for his own identity. He fought as a Shudra where he should have and could have fought as a Kshatriya, right? And that's where he, despite finding his dharma, he did not choose to take it up, whereas Arjun took it up and fought for the dharma, right? So there was a conscious war and there was an unconscious war simultaneously in the Mahabharata. So what I'd like for us to take away from the story of Karna is looking at what's our dharma, where is the Karna in us? Are there times when we are loyal habitually to the conditioning that we are brought up with, the beliefs that we are brought up with, which may not necessarily be our temperaments? A lot of times we live loyally to what our parents believe, to what our community believes, to what our religion believes, whereas that may not be us, that may not be our temperament at all. So is there something that we are habitually and conditionally loyal to, and is it time to break that? Is it time to step away, gently so, but step away from the fact that your parents' beliefs, your family's beliefs may be different from yours, and that's okay. They are all right where they are, and we are okay where we are. So what are those conditioning pieces that hold us back from our dharma, our duty towards our own evolution? One clue to do that is to look at, what do I long for? What is my deepest longing? Do I wish to serve the world in a particular way? How do I want to contribute towards people around me, to the planet that I live on? And how do I, very importantly, act on it? It's not only about knowing my dharma. Karna, at the end of his life, knew it. He didn't do anything about it. So the lesson for me personally from the story of Karna is to say, if I know my dharma, what am I doing about it? How do I choose to act? Regardless of the fact that yes, there will be opinions around, there will be conflicts around, and that's okay, all of us are evolving at different paces, and yet it's important to evolve. If I refuse to evolve just because I've been conditioned to behave in a certain way, then I'm not doing my duty towards life in general, not doing my duty towards myself in general. So that's what I leave us with. How do you find your own dharma? Thank you.